Okay, so after that very nice talk by Jim Gates, now we're talking about the experience of African Americans in American academia. I'm very happy to have as the next speaker Professor Shobhana Narasimhan about an experiences of a woman scientist working in a society like India. I know Shobhana very well as she has been a good friend, and in fact we sort of went to graduate school to the US at the same time. She graduated from Harvard. Her main area of interest is in computational nanoscience, examining lowering of dimensionality and reduction of size effects in material properties. And she has been a fellow of several academies, including the Indian Academy of Sciences, National Academy of Sciences in India. And she's also an international honorary member of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences, and a recipient of a number of awards. But in addition to her work as a scientist, she has also has a long connection with ICTP, much like Jim Gates. In various capacities, as a visiting scientist, but also she has been a very strong supporter of our Women in Science program, and she has been driving it quite actively and enthusiastically. So I'm very happy for her to be giving this talk today. Also, another connection that she has with ICTP is that her father, who was also himself a major mathematician from India, M.S. Narasimhan, he was the head of ICTP. Unfortunately, he passed away recently, but he was the head of the ICTP math section. And he, so therefore, she has yet another connection with ICTP. So welcome, Shobhana. And now I give the floor to her.
Thank you, Atish. Thanks for that kind introduction. I'm very happy to be giving this talk. ICTP is very close to my heart. It's really my second home, I think. And, So I'm really very happy, and I think the diploma program, though I'm not a former diploma student myself, I think it's a fantastic program, really one of the jewels in the crown of ICTP's portfolio, and I'm very happy to be a part of this event. So I've been asked to talk about fighting systemic gender discrimination in science. This picture on the cover, I don't know if any of you can make out where it was taken. It was taken on the terrace of the Adriatico. So to start with, let me say that gender discrimination can be targeted at women or also at sexual minorities, LGBTQ, etc. In this talk, I will discuss only the situation of women because this is what most information is available about, and this is what I'm familiar with. This is not to minimize other forms of gender discrimination. So what are the challenges faced by women in building their careers in science? I'm sure most of you are aware of it. It's been mentioned already by previous speakers today. They're very few in number. They face pressures due to family responsibilities. They face discrimination and bias. This might be implicit or it might be explicit. They can face isolation, a lack of peer group and mentorship, a hostile work environment sometimes, sexual harassment, and a lack of recognition. Because of the limited time available to me today, I'm going to talk about these three topics. I will tell you that women are a minority in science. This, of course, everybody is available of. I ought to warn you that my neighbor's cat has come into my house and it is approaching the computer. So it's quite possible that some unfortunate event will occur very soon. Okay, women frequently face discrimination, and I'll talk about some ways to combat discrimination. So women are a minority in science. So historically, of course, the number of women in science has been low. This is a very famous picture that was taken at the Solvay conference in 1927. It is sometimes called the picture of the brightest minds ever, because nearly everyone in this picture went on to win a Nobel Prize. And of course, there's only one woman in this picture, which is Marie Curie. And you may say, oh, but this was taken in 1927. That was almost 100 years ago. Things have changed a lot since then. Well, they haven't changed that much. This was a picture that was taken at a conference in 2010 that I was a part of. And can you find me? Can you find any women at all? Well, I am there. If you look very carefully, you can see that I'm there. And I was one of only two women. There was one other woman here. Also, as you might notice, there are very few people of color. There were a lot of Chinese people because the conference took place in Shanghai. So things, we really do not have much diversity in science, considering how much time has passed. So this is a map that shows the percentage of scientists in a country who are women, and the darker the color shading of that country, the greater the percentage of women. And you can see that pretty much everywhere, the shading is very light, indicating that women are a minority. There's only about 10 countries in the world where about 50% of the scientists are women. And there's only one country, which is here, which is Myanmar, Burma, where it's over 70% of the scientists are women. So here are some of the numbers. These are UNESCO statistics. So in the world as a whole, 28.8% of scientists are women. But you see, there are big regional variations, and you might be surprised by some of these numbers because they may not meet your preconceptions or your biases, whatever. The highest percentage is in Central Asia, 48.1%. The lowest is in South and West Asia. You notice, for example, the Arab states have a high percentage, 39.8%. And if you look at North America and Western Europe, it's 32.3%, which is almost the same as you have in sub-Saharan Africa. And these are statistics separated by geographical area, by continent. So these are the numbers for Asia. The highest is Myanmar. The lowest is Nepal. India is the second lowest in Asia, which really shocked me when I first saw it. I didn't expect that. These are the numbers for Africa. The highest is Tunisia. The lowest is Chad. These are the numbers for Latin America. Latin America in general has a high percentage of women in science. The highest is Bolivia at 62.7%. And the lowest is Peru at 31.9%. So every country in Latin America has a higher percentage than the world average. These are the gender ratios for the ICTP diploma program. 28% of all diploma students, if you look at it over the years, have been women. And I told you that 28.8% of scientists in the world are women. So that's exactly matching. But in fact, the diploma program has probably done better than you see participation ratios in the world, because this includes statistics from early years where the percentage of women in science was lower. I decided to look at these statistics a little more because I'm from a developing country myself. And I began to wonder, are there any differences between developing countries and developed countries? I mean, you might think, oh, developed countries have a lot of women in science and developing countries have fewer. Is that really true, or is it the opposite? So one of the things I did over this past pandemic year was do some research into these kinds of statistics. So the question, first question I asked myself is there any correlation between the participation of women in science in a country and the wealth of that country? So what I did was I looked at the percentage of women in the scientific workforce of that country versus the per capita GDP of that country, the gross domestic product, adjusted for purchasing power parity. And when I plotted it, I found something really surprising, which is I found here on this axis is the percentage of women scientists in a country. And on this axis is the gross domestic product adjusted for purchasing power parity. And you get this inverted U-shaped curve. So the very poorest countries have very few women doing science, which is not very surprising. And then it rises quite sharply as the country becomes richer. But then what's really surprising is as it maximizes somewhere here. And then as the country becomes richer and richer and richer, the percentage of women doing science in the country falls. So you get this inverted U-shaped curve. And it was especially surprising for me to see this because in development economics, people have known for quite a long time that if you look at the participation of women in the labor workforce as a whole, you see exactly the opposite. You don't see an inverted U, you see a right side up U. That is, you see that the poorest countries and the richest countries have lots of women working, and you see fewer women working in the middle income countries. So there's something about science that makes it very different from other forms of labor, so that you see exactly the opposite pattern. I don't have a definite answer for why this is. This is something I want to look at more, but we can discuss this, I hope, in the question answer session. I have some ideas. I've looked at various other things. Today, I'll just talk about one other thing I've looked at, which is whether we can see trends in patterns of dropout or retention, that is women leaving science, which is a big problem. So for that, I looked at the percentage of women studying science at the tertiary education level, that is in college, versus the percentage of women working in the scientific workforce. And I separated the data into the developed countries, countries defined as developed if it has a high GDP. So here there are blue bars and orange bars. A blue bar tells you the percentage of students studying science in the country who are women. And the orange bar tells you the percentage of scientists in the country who are women. And the data fell into two groups, okay? So these that I've circled here, these are the countries in the Middle East, the oil-rich countries of the Persian Gulf, Oman, Kuwait, Bahrain, Brunei, Qatar, Saudi Arabia, and also South Korea. You see a big drop. So women are dropping out of science after having studied it at college. Okay, so presumably they're getting married, they're having children, and they're leaving science. Whereas for all the other developed countries, this blue bar and this orange bar are almost the same height. And so this suggests that in these countries, which also have lower participation of women in science in general, the real problem is at the early stage. Women are not getting attracted to study science in school or in college. So you have to have different strategies if you want to address the problem of low participation of women in science in these two groups of countries. Now, if you look at the developing countries, then with the exception of a few formerly communist countries, you see the first pattern, which is that you see a big drop from college to working as a scientist. So a lot of women are studying science, they're getting attracted to study science, but they are not continuing in science afterwards. They're not working in science. Okay, so now I want to talk a bit about the kinds of discrimination that women face. This is obviously a big topic. I can't cover the whole thing, but I will say a little bit about it. So my title was about systemic discrimination in science. So what do we mean by systemic discrimination? It's asking whether the processes and organizational culture of science, do they somehow, do the ways we practice science today, the way science is structured, does that somehow result in discrimination against women? And often possibly without conscious intent. It's not, I mean, there is of course a lot of explicit discrimination where, you know, people may say, oh, I don't want any women in my lab. I'm not gonna choose any women for this position. But there is something much more insidious where people may be discriminating without even being aware that they are discriminating. So there was a big survey just last year. It was called the Gender Gap in Science, which surveyed more than 32,000 scientists from 159 countries. And they asked them lots of questions, and they found that men are 4.8 times as likely to say that they have never experienced discrimination as women. So women are saying that they are facing discrimination. So what kinds of discrimination might women face? So here, so one thing you might say is, oh, well, maybe women are not getting jobs. Maybe they're not getting grants because they're just not as good, or they're just not as productive. Maybe they're not writing enough papers. Maybe they're just not as driven. So here was this study. It's a very famous study that was done in Sweden. And it looked at grants that were given to applicants. And it tried to quantify their ability and their performance in a numerical way. That is, it looked at how many papers they had published, where they had published, where they had studied, etc. So it was trying to put an objective numerical score on their performance and competence. And then on this y-axis is how they were evaluated by the reviewers who were deciding whether they should get this grant or not. Okay, so in this case, you are really comparing like with like. You're comparing men and women who have exactly similar CVs, okay? I mean, they're published the same, at the same rate in the same journals, etc. And what you see is that men are ranked much higher than women who have the same score, okay? And in fact, women had to perform 2.5 times as well to get the same score as men. And they also said, in the sort of numerical rating scheme they had, this was equivalent to having to publish 3 extra papers in science or nature. So that's a huge additional barrier for women. I mean, if they have to do that much extra to get just the same rating as a man. So this suggests that there is something else going on here. I mean, men and women are just not being evaluated similarly. There was another similar study that was done more recently. This was published in PNAS, where people just made up a CV for an applicant for a position in a lab. And they took the identical CV and they sent it to men and women professors asking if they would give them the job. And not perhaps that surprisingly, if the CV had a male name on it, people were much more likely to say they would be willing to give that person a job. They were also willing to offer them a higher salary. And the interesting thing is that this was both men and women who were doing this, okay? So why do we do this? Why do we rate men and women higher? Of course, some people may just be very sexist and very chauvinist and think that women cannot do science, etc. But there may be other things at play as well. So here I'm going to tell you a confession about myself, okay? So I grew up in a very liberal household. I was encouraged to do whatever I wanted to do by both my mother and my father. My mother is a well-known scientific feminist author. But the first time that I went in a plane that was piloted by a woman, the captain's voice came on over the intercom and she said, "Hello, this is your captain speaking." And for just that fraction of a second, this thought crossed my mind, "Oh my God, the pilot is a woman. I hope she knows how to fly this plane." And then I was, of course, immediately horrified at myself, really shocked. I thought, how can I think like that? This is completely against everything that I believe in so strongly. So why do we have these biases? Why do we have these thought patterns? It's because everything in the media, in our schools, in our friends, our families are bombarding us with these messages that men should do certain things and women should do certain things. So this is, for example, a page from an elementary school textbook in India, and it is showing different professions. And a woman is being shown here as a school teacher, but all the other professions, you know, a doctor, someone doing a computer, a farmer, a potter, a judge, everybody else is being shown as a man. And you, these images really bury themselves deep in our psyche, and we have certain biases. Now, what other challenges can women in science face? Okay, this is a picture that I think typifies what I have faced as a woman in science, and many women say they can identify with it, which is after work, my male colleagues will all get together and go for a beer, and I would never be invited to go along. Now you may think, well, so what? I mean, they're just socializing. If they don't want to socialize with me, it's okay. But it's more than just socializing. Of course, I feel a bit lonely. I feel left out. But these after work gatherings are extremely important to one's career, because this is where collaborations are forged. This is where men give each other advice about how to reply to a referee report, how to apply for a grant, etc. And if women are left out of this, either because it is not socially acceptable for them to go to these things, or because they just have family responsibilities and they don't have the time to socialize, they're totally left out. So women lack this whole access to this kind of old boys network. Now, let me tell you a little story about myself. Once the guys at work were going out to drink, and I asked them, I mean, I know that they never asked me, but that day I just somehow felt like going along, and I said, "Can I come too?" And they kind of looked at each other and then they said, "No." And I was really horrified. And I said, "What do you mean no? How can you say no?" And one of them said to me, "A decent woman wouldn't come where we're going." And I was so shocked. I mean, I still don't know where they were planning to go. Things have changed since then. I get along much better with them, and they do sometimes invite me along. But this tells you that it's not, I mean, it's not a really inclusive environment that we face at work. This is about man-terrupting and bro-creating. This is, again, something that's not very explicit discrimination, but it's something that a lot of women say they face. you're talking and men keep interrupting you, or a man takes your idea and takes credit for it. This picture I didn't put from science. It was a notorious occasion at the MTV Music Awards where Taylor Swift was giving a talk and Kanye West just grabbed the mic from her and spoke. This is something we've all faced, you know? I mean, I would be saying something at a meeting or in the question answer session after a talk, and people would just ignore me. It would be as if I hadn't spoken. And then a man would say the same thing and they would say, oh, that's an excellent point. And I would think, but I just said that. And you know, you're just not, you're not listened to, which can be very frustrating. This is about women in science academies, about the recognition given to women. This, the countries are colored according to the percentage of women in their science academies. The percentage is really, really low, nearly everywhere in the world. Another recognition about Nobel Prizes. This is the statistics for the number of Nobel Prizes won by women. And in science, the percentage is 3%. And that is just shockingly low, really, really low. Okay. And of course, there you see a picture of Marie Curie. She's very famous for having won 2 Nobel Prizes. So how did she win 2 Nobel Prizes? Well, the story of her first Nobel Prize was that only Becquerel and Pierre Curie were nominated, and she was not nominated, and they were planning to give it to 2 of them. And Pierre Curie was informed about this, and he wrote to the committee that if it is true that one is seriously thinking about me, I very much wish to be considered together with Madame Curie. So she got it because her husband pleaded for her. And there are many, many, many stories I can tell you about women who did path-breaking work, and the credit went to some man instead, and he was given the Nobel Prize for it. I can tell stories for other awards. Sexual harassment is really widely prevalent. It is quite shocking how prevalent it is. This is again from the gender gap in science. The green bars are women and the orange bars are men. This is the percentage indicating that they personally encountered sexual harassment at school or the workplace. And in general, 20 to 30 or even 40% of women say they have personally encountered it. There is a small percentage of men who say they've encountered it, but it's about 2 to 5%. So this is really a huge problem that women face. So now for the rest of the time, I want to talk about some ways to combat discrimination. I don't have all the solutions, but I just want to throw out some ideas. You can raise awareness, call out bias and discrimination, build support networks, hold workshops, form alliances and associations, start targeted programs, increase the representation of women on committees, and formulate laws and policies. So I told you that there's implicit bias, bias that you're not even aware that you have. So Google implicit bias in Harvard, and you will go to this website where there are various tests for whether you have implicit bias on various things. And one of them is about women and science. And take this test and see whether you have implicit bias. And do it regardless of whether you're a man or a woman. And let's see what you find out. Okay, the first time I took the test, I was quite shocked. It showed that I had a lot of bias that men should do science and women should do non-science jobs. Over the years, my results, I keep taking the test and my results have changed. And now it says I have a bias the opposite direction. But maybe I'm cheating a little bit because now I know the test, how the test works. I don't know. You can share stories. We've been doing this a lot in India. This is a book of stories of women scientists. This is a more the same thing tailored for a younger audience. There are books like this, which are aimed at young girls, telling them stories of women in science. I know the African Academies of Science have recently brought out a pamphlet of stories of women in science. I'm now going to tell you a lot about India because that is what I'm familiar with, but there are, of course, initiatives all around the world. So for example, in India, there's this website called thelifeofscience.com, and it's a website, and it features stories of women, especially women from marginalized communities, what are called the backward castes, the disadvantaged communities, who have chosen to take science as a career. I think having a website is relatively easy because you don't need much infrastructure, you don't need much money. One thing that you see a lot are what are called MANLs. MANL means male panel. So there are lots of conferences where all the speakers are male or almost no female speakers. So this, for example, was one in India, which was advertised in the newspaper, and it said eminent speakers, Digitech Conclave, every single speaker was male. I've even seen advertisements for conferences about women in science where all the speakers were male, which you may think is impossible, but it has happened. Okay, so what can one do about it? Well, I myself, every time I see this, I write a mail to the organizers saying, dear organizers, you don't have gender balance in your conference, etc. Sometimes they get irritated. So they probably are thinking, oh God, there she goes again. But I think if you keep doing it, you raise awareness. But there are also groups, for example, in India recently, a group has been established called biaswatchindia.com. And what they did is first they established what they call a base rate. So they looked at all the institutions in India, the leading institutions, and they looked at the percentage of their faculty who were female. Okay, so these are the numbers. So in biology, it's 22.3%, mathematics, 15.4%, computer science, 11.1%, et cetera, all the way down to engineering, which is 7.9%. So these are, of course, very low numbers. But what is shocking is that the percentage of speakers at conferences or the percentage of women on a committee tends to be even lower than this. So they monitor it, which is very easy to do now because all this information is up on the web. So for example, here was one conference in biology that was held recently, and they tweeted it. They said, out of 7 speakers, 0 were women. Out of 1 moderator, 1 was a woman. And then they have said the base rate of women faculty in biology is 23.2%. So the argument is that if your number of speakers, women speakers, falls below the base rate in that field, then you are probably discriminating. You're not looking at the available pool of women scientists who could be speakers. How can you change this? So this is a series of conferences that was held at ICTP. It's called the Total Energy Conference. It's held once every 2 years. And this is, the blue bar is men and the red bar is women. So you see, initially there were almost all male speakers, very few female speakers. And we kept saying, you should have more women, you should have more women, you should have more women. Then what happened in 2017 is there are always 3 conference directors, as you know, at ICTP conferences, and all 3 of us were women. Okay, so that's me over there. And we made a special effort not to choose more women, but to suggest more women as possible speakers. And then there is an international committee which votes on the speakers based on the interest in the topic, their skill as a speaker, et cetera. And then you see what happened. That year, 1/3 of the speakers were women, and many people told us that that was one of the best conferences ever. So including women as speakers and organizers at conferences is important. And if you make a special effort, you can have lots of women as speakers. This is an example of a petition that was raised. So this is called the International Congress of Quantum Chemistry. It's an international conference that moves around from country to country. And in 2015, they put up their program, their list of invited speakers and plenary speakers, and there wasn't a single woman amongst the list. And so what a group of women did was they started a petition on change.org. You may be aware of this website. It's where you can start up petitions and get people to sign online. And, you know, I think hundreds and hundreds of people signed, saying it was clear that discrimination is taking place if there are no women speakers at this conference. Okay. And then they actually changed it. They said, sorry, that was a premature posting, whatever that means, of an all-male list. And they apologized and they redid their list and added women speakers. So you can change things. So what are the activities you can do to build a support network? You can have just lunches, meetings online, panel discussions, scientific talks, talks by role models, career development workshops, which I'll talk about now, leadership development workshops, mentoring, outreach programs, screening programs, and internet databases. I don't have time to talk about all this, so I'll just talk about career development workshops. So this is something we've been doing at ICTP and that Atish Dabholkar mentioned. So we've been having them at ICTP every other year. We've also done one at the ICTP Partner Institute in Rwanda. So the aims of our workshops is to give women a space for in which they can share their experiences, acquire skills to rise in their career, and form a community that can support one another. So as I said, that women lack access to this old boys network. So we want to give an alternative to that. So these are the organizers. That's me there. Liz Simmons, Erica Coppola, whom some of you may know, and Nicola Spalding, who was the director 1 year, and Marie Chantal, who was the director when we did it in Rwanda. The participants have come from all over the world. We've had participants from about 80 countries so far. Now, people ask me, why should you have something just for women? Isn't that discriminatory? So I have various answers to this. Sometimes women are just more comfortable talking about sort of traumatic experiences, etc., if there are only women present. But let me tell you about this story of the first time we did it. There was one woman who told us, this is the first conference of any kind that I've attended, because this is the first conference my husband allowed me to attend. And he allowed me to attend this one because I told him that only women would be there. So there are women who have all kinds of challenges that they face, all kinds of backgrounds that they're from. And we have to cater to all these different situations. If you're thinking about doing some activity like this, I would urge you to include social scientists because they have a lot of experience with dealing with such situations. For example, these are my friends and colleagues, Anuradha and Maitri, who helped me design a program that was inclusive, that everyone participated in. I will talk more about it. I also think it's quite important to involve men because I think it's important to give the message that there are supportive men and that men are not the enemy. I like this particular picture because it shows a man surrounded by a sea of women, which is exactly the opposite of what you usually see at a physics conference. We've had talks by inspiring role models. This is Jocelyn Bell Burnell, who was one of the notorious cases where she did amazing work. She discovered pulsars, and she was not given the Nobel Prize for it, which is seen as a big miscarriage of justice. But she did receive the breakthrough prize in fundamental physics, which is $3 million just a few years ago. We've had talks by very inspiring role models. For example, this is Setsuko Tajima from Japan, who had a break in her career after she had children and would just go into work in the lab one day a week just because she loved physics so much, and eventually ended up having a fantastic career in physics. This is Sossina Haile, who is a professor at Caltech and is now at Northwestern and grew up in Ethiopia. We've shared our stories. This is Rabia Saeed from Nigeria, who has an amazing personal story. She got married straight after out of school. She had six children. Two of them had severe health problems, but she went on to do a bachelor's, a master's, and a PhD. This is Ivana Vobornik, who had to escape the war in Sarajevo in order to do her PhD in physics. This is Shazreen Mohammed from Zimbabwe, who also has an amazing trajectory. I don't have the time to tell you about all these amazing women. We also work on helping women improve what are called soft skills, like how to write a paper for publication, how to make slides, how to deliver a talk, how to write grant applications, how to negotiate. Negotiating is very important because women tend to be uncomfortable asking for things, whether it is less teaching load or a bigger salary or more lab space or more money for equipment. So we train women how to negotiate for things, how to make a professional looking CV, et cetera. So here are just some pictures from that. These women in groups of four working on their CVs. This is after we had a workshop on how to give effective talks. Every woman at the workshop gave a 1 minute talk introducing her research topic. I think just from these pictures, you can tell that they gave fantastic talks. We do something very interesting, which is a drama workshop, where we have a trained counselor who uses techniques of drama to help us talk about challenges we face in our either balancing career and family or in a hostile work environment. Women say this is a very transformative experience, this workshop. We have poster sessions. We have panel discussions, how to pick a research topic, women in physics in Africa, how to balance a career and family. We have exercises on how to pick a research topic. Women do get together and discuss science. And these are some of the things women said afterwards when they were asked what they found about the workshop. They said they found that we all share the same problems regardless of our country, culture, and religion. They gained from it a great deal of confidence. And most importantly, they felt that they're not alone. They have a support network. Many women who have attended this have gone on to conduct similar workshops in their countries. For example, this is in Uzbekistan. This one is in India. I'm gonna skip this. I'm gonna tell you a story from our workshop. So Zipporah, who was a PhD student from Kenya, came to our first workshop, and she had a PhD fellowship but no research topic, and she felt very lost and confused. And Aarti, who was from India, had many ideas for research, but she didn't have enough students to carry them out. And they connected at our workshop and went on to work together, and they've published several papers together. And Aarti, sort of long distance, was Zipporah's PhD advisor. So this is the kind of thing we've done at our workshops. This is at the end of one of our workshops. You can just see how much positive energy was generated at our workshop. And we continue to stay in touch through Zoom. I also do Zoom meetings with all the women who have ever been in my group. We meet once a month and just share our stories. And if you want to do something like this, there are also many resources available online. So I just, you know, there are lots of YouTube videos, etc. I just end by saying a couple of other things that you can, that governments have done. So for example, in India, we realized that the big problem was we had quite a lot of women doing science PhDs, but we were losing them to science after the PhD. So the government started these fellowships specifically for women who've had a break in career after their PhD, and they can either come back to science and be funded for 3 to 5 years, or they can be trained in science-related careers like patent law, et cetera. The government has also set up technology parks for women who would like to do a science startup, like become entrepreneurs. In England, there's something called the Athena Swan Program, which rates institutions according to how gender inclusive they are. They can get a gold rating or a silver rating or a bronze rating. And many funding agencies now are starting to link government funding to what rating they get. So this is a real incentive for institutions to change, to become more gender inclusive. I just want to say that you can lobby for change. You can lobby for representation of women amongst faculty members, committees, conference speakers, journal editorial boards, winners of prizes and awards. If you have a hostile climate, if there's sexual harassment, if you don't have good maternity and childcare leave, age limits. But I just want to say that when you lobby, it's very hard to lobby as an individual. So it's much better to lobby as a group than as an individual. And nowadays with connectivity so high and social media, et cetera, it's not so hard to build a support group so that you can lobby collectively. So that's all I wanted to say. And to women, I want to say, stay strong and don't give up. And to men, I say, educate yourself about the problems that women face and do be supportive. Thank you very much.
Okay. Well, thank you, Shobhana, once again for another insightful talk, connecting, you know, personal experience with a broader view and also some hard statistics. So I think these are, I mean, it's fundamental to ICTP's mission to overcome these barriers of gender, geography, ethnicity, and economics. And we are seeing different aspects of this kind of discrimination, both implicit and explicit. And I know that this Women in Science program has been, we are very proud to support it at ICTP. Has been quite successful in terms of the impact it has had. I had the opportunity to attend or sort of hear direct testimonials from some of the workshop participants. In fact, I was invited as a panelist a couple of times, and it was also a situation where I got to experience where I was the token male panel member in the sea of women panel members. So it was an experience to understand how it feels to be the other way around. But I think ICTP is committed. I know that there are a lot of very interesting questions because I think it's something that is important to all this women scientists who are want to make a career. For example, things like daycare has come up, I saw, and I want to say that ICTP is very committed. We already have taken note of this. There are many logistic difficulties, but we have launched preliminary daycare facilities at ICTP, and a few people who did access them, you know, despite COVID. were extremely happy about it. But these are the kind of things that an institution like ICTP needs to keep in mind, that in what way, in a systematic way, we can address some of the barriers that exist. So I will now hand over the floor to Paolo to take questions. Thanks. So thanks.
Yeah, Shobhana. There's so many questions in the chat. I don't know, I mean, which ones to take. So
yes,
Paolo will moderate. So thanks.
Yeah. Many people have asked for the slides. I have already sent my slides to Paolo, so perhaps he can share them somewhere.
Yes, I will. So first of all, if we can unmute Angie Arfani, she has a question. She raised her hand. So if ICTS can. Angie, you can talk, please.
Yeah. Hello, everybody. Thank you so much for ICTP for having this anniversary meeting, and also for Shobhana for a really great talk. Actually, I wanted to comment about something that I raised as a special diploma program for females, if it's possible by ICTP, especially in the basic physics, because we know that in some of the countries, we have a lack of the physics, especially in the case of the master and PhD level, especially for females. It would be really great if ICTP is going to have a special program for them, not just in high energy physics and mathematics or condensed matter, just in basic science, because they are really limited. And also I want to raise some other issue regarding the next year, which is called as the International Year for Basic Sciences and Sustainable Development. And we know that the sustainable development will not happen by ignoring the women in science, in basic sciences. So I suggest ICTP to have the women physicist organization, because ICTP has is one of the international institutes in physics and has a really good connection between developing and developed countries. So it would be a really great chance if we can have female physicist organization establishing ICTP, if it's possible by the rules. Thank you so much.
Okay, maybe I would suggest you to maybe send this suggestion in writing, you know, to our organizers so that we can follow it up.
I have a question for her. Why do you think you should have a diploma program just for women rather than just making sure you have a large number of women amongst the diploma students? Hello?
Inche, the question is for you, but now you're muted.
Okay, maybe we take it later. Okay, maybe we go to the next question then.
Maybe. Well, it would be better. Can ICTS unmute Angie?
Yeah, I can answer that, because I'm from a developing country, and I know that, for example, the high energy physics and mathematics, there are really few females. And it's really difficult to find the really candidates that they can participate in the diploma courses. But if it's going for the basic sciences in general, we know that there are many of them who got their bachelor or they got their master. So it'd be really great to have them after their studies to do these basic sciences, not just going to the high energy physics and also for the mathematics or going for condensed matter. Because even in the future, finding the jobs in theoretical physics is really difficult for them. If having a specific program just in basic science for females and give them the chance to get familiar with the other subjects of the physics, that will help them to find their career in the future, especially to become a PhD students and find their way. Because you know that theoretical physics is not really common subjects in the case of even the physics. And then women are really minority in STEAM in general. I hope I answered the question.
Okay, I mean, you've given me some food for thought. I need to think more about it, whether there are certain fields of physics which have less representation of women and what you should do about that.
I see a question by Valverde, so we can unmute her or him. Can ICTS unmute Valverde? She or he raised the hand. Please go ahead.
Hello, thanks for the great talk, Shobhana. So I had a question. You showed a plot comparing the population of women that went to do their undergrad studies with the percentage, I think, of women that stay in science. So I was wondering how you counted the women that stayed in science, from which, let's say, degree of seniority, if they had
permanent. Okay. So I didn't get those statistics. They are UNESCO statistics, and they don't really specify. They just say they look at the R&D researchers in that country and what percentage are women. So I am assuming that they're looking at people who have permanent jobs at all levels.
Okay, thank you.
Yes, maybe let me read. There are some nice comments that maybe Shobhana can elaborate on. For instance, Sarah Oliva says, I know of men who make a point to decline invitations to be a part of a manel, a all-men panel, and instead of recommend a list of women colleagues who can do the job as well.
So yes, I think that's an excellent thing to do. I'm very happy to hear that there are men who do this. I know women who do this in the sense that if there are not enough women speaking, they refuse to be a part. And I have written to men suggesting that they refuse to be a part of a manel, but I don't know if they've actually done it. But I think it would be great, for example, if everybody attending this talk, all the men attending this talk said that they will not take part in any all-male manel.
Good point, good point. Let me read another comment. I think women having supportive husband and in-laws do better than others. Perhaps women who are not married do better, since marriage and in-laws are obstacle to career for women unless they extend due support.
I think that is true. A friend recently told me something, but I haven't seen the statistics, and so I don't know where she saw it, but she told me if you look at who performs best in whatever that means, first is married men, then is unmarried men, then is unmarried women, and then is married women. So marriage actually helps a man a lot in his career, but marriage typically hinders a woman in career progression, presumably because she gets a lot of household responsibilities and childcare responsibilities, which make it difficult for her to devote enough time to her career. But a friend of mine, I myself am not married, but a friend of mine said that if she was asked one piece of advice to give a young woman in science, it would be choose your spouse or partner very, very carefully, because that is the most important decision you make, both for your personal life and for your career.
Good. Let me maybe Nushka, you want to read to speak yourself about your question about alumni. Maybe ICTS can unmute Nushka Chamba.
Hi, can you hear me well?
Yes, we can. Go ahead,
please. Shobhana, your talk was really excellent. Thank you so much for giving such a great topic overview. I actually have several comments on you know, many of the things you discussed, but I think the question Paolo is mentioning is about, I asked, do you think we should create a subgroup of women, ICTP alumni who are women, within you know, this conference or even in general, and what do you envision this group should have as the main mission to reach more women in science? And I mean, I think ICTP is already doing a lot of things, but do you think we should put more effort into this.
I definitely think that's an excellent suggestion. And especially nowadays with social media, it's so easy to set up a group like that. It could be, I don't know, a Facebook group, a WhatsApp group, whatever. I mean, I know Facebook and WhatsApp are really old fashioned, and I don't know what other newer things. But I mean, like, we've done that with some of the people who took part in the career development workshops I've organized. Mm-hmm. And I mean, what they can do, it depends. You can either have it as a loose thing where people, you know, just, you know, if somebody's organizing a talk or somebody knows that there's a fellowship for women, they put it, etc. Or you can have it more structured. For example, senior women can mentor the more junior women in a structured way. Mm-hmm. Like you can have, for example, if the diploma students each had a senior woman as a mentor, then it would be perhaps nice for them to mm-hmm. have someone to whom they could bounce off ideas, etc. In fact, that would be fantastic even for the male students, I think. I mean,
I agree. Yeah.
And, you know, or you can have a meeting once a month online, and whoever feels like can join. I do that with many of the women networks I'm part of. Not everybody takes part every time, but once mm-hmm. in a while people join, and whatever they feel like talking about, they share it. And I think just sharing experiences itself is an extremely powerful thing. It mm-hmm. really helps you hugely when you're facing various challenges. First of all, to hear that other women face the same challenges. And secondly, sometimes you get advice about how to cope with them.
Yeah, I mean, you know, just related to the point that you mentioned before about marriage and how that affects career. I mean, what I was thinking of was that, because you mentioned, okay, we need to choose up our spouses carefully. And I was thinking, wow, but there are so many women who don't get that choice. Especially, you know, even in my country, you know, many women, I mean, they get married right after high school or even sometimes before that. And so even before they realize that they would like to have a career, that option is, you know, already sort of.
Yeah. So, you know, there. What one of the women at one of our workshops said, which I thought was very powerful image and stayed with me. She said, my advice to women is be like a snail. And I thought, what does she mean? Mm-hmm. And she said, creep forward slowly, 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 so that nobody even notices that you are moving forward. When there's danger, go back into your shell. And then when the danger has passed, come out of your shell again and move forward slowly, slowly, slowly. And for me, that was a really powerful image because it was so different from the way I think and had been told to think. I mean, I'd always been told, you know, fight, you know, don't take any nonsense, complain, etc. But I realized for many women, that is just not an option. And there are other paradigms, other ways of dealing with situations. And those can also be very powerful ways of dealing with situations.
Mm. Thank you. Thank you for your response.
Okay, I see many, many, many remarks on the chat, but maybe we should close. We're running rather late. So let me thank Shobhana again for her talk. So her slides will be distributed. And okay, it's time to close. So let me remind you that so tomorrow we start at 3 p.m. and the discussion tomorrow will be mostly by diploma students. There will be many diploma students presenting what happened in these regional meetings. There will be a discussion about this roundtable with notable ex-diploma students. Let me also remind you that there will be the group photo at 2:45 and wear your t-shirt if you can. And finally, let me remind you about WonderMe. So if you want to go around and meet all the new friends, you can use this platform. The link is on the program. So you can find the program on the website. You just click on it and you would find with your avatar in this platform, and you can chat and talk with the other diploma students. Okay, so
Paolo, I just want to interrupt. Shobhana, I forgot to say one thing. I really want to thank ICTP and acknowledge all the support we've got for the programs we've held at ICTP in Trieste and Kigali. And without the support of many people, we would not have been able to do it.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Shobhana. Okay, we can close here, and thank you very much. And we reconvene tomorrow at 3 p.m. Trieste time. Thank you.